Looks like we are rolling. So good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for joining and welcome. It is the Spring Perimeter Pro webinar in 2024. Hard to believe. My name is Scott Etheridge. I am one of the product managers here at BASF. Specifically, I manage our termite portfolio, so Termidor, Trelona, and Advance. So I am especially excited because today's topic is termites. Hopefully everybody is just as excited as me. You're seeing swarms pop up. It is that time of year. And we also have a expert here in the field, Dr. Freder Medina. Freder has a very extensive experience in the pest control industry. We don't have time to go through all of his accomplishments, but I will just say you're in for a treat and a really cool presentation today. Freder's going to speak specifically about integrated termite management. So I think we talk a lot about IPM. This is a little bit of a twist on that specific to termites and the need to be very strategic in how you go out and control termites. So a couple of housekeeping things before we do get started. Number one, there's going to be a prize drawing. So I'm really excited. We have three Yetis that we're going to be giving out. There's going to be a random drawing. If you win, you will be notified after we wrap up in a couple of days. You will get an email. Also, if you want to rewatch this, if you want to share this with someone on your team that's not able to join today, we're going to send a link to view the webinar and the training presentation that Freder is going to give. So a lot of exciting stuff, and we will go ahead and jump right in. So before we get to Freder's presentation, I just wanted to remind everyone of what Perimeter Pro is. So this is something from a BASF perspective that we call the keys to the game. So really the three pillars of that, number one, as with any type of pest strategy, we always like to talk about the importance of IPM. So before there's any chemical application, or if there's a chemical application, you always start with a thorough inspection. Always think about what you can do from an exclusion standpoint. What you can do to address pest habitats, and all of those things are going to make your chemical application that much more successful. Number two is all about once you've chosen a chemical application, what products you deploy. We all like our star players, right? Make sure that you have the right rotation even within those star players, so your foundational products can still have different mode of actions, different active ingredients. If it's a bait type of product, different bait matrices. And always look at what frequency you're able to apply those per the label. The last piece is your bullpen, right? So when you need that really strategic, specialized application, this is where you have those ready-to-use products ready to go and to come in and apply for those targeted applications. So with that, I want to share an example from a BASF perspective of what we would call our starting rotation. So no big surprise here, but Termidor is really still the foundational superior product for perimeter control. So Alpine WSG is an excellent one-two punch. If you think about Termidor and its non-repellent and other type of transfer and things that it's able to do, Alpine is a great combo to that. Another non-repellent product, but gives you some flexibility on and off structure, indoors, et cetera. The last one that we have listed from a dilutable standpoint is Findona. So you've probably heard a lot about Findona. Really great microcap pyrethroid, specifically if you're going after mosquitoes, if you're going after scorpions out west, also a great spider control product, and really a really good long-lasting quarterly maintenance control product as well. For your bullpen, tons of options here. Foam, we have a couple of foam applications, Termidor and Alpine. So if you've used some of the Termidor and Alpine products but need a different type of application, foam is a great place to start. Tons of pressurized products, right? We have a pressurized solution really for any situation you're going to come to. Some Findona, Phantom, Alpine, and a lot of baits as well, specifically on the ant side. So advanced branded ant baits, we have 375A, kind of your general workhorse, carpenter ant baits, et cetera. Mother Earth's a great scatter bait, and then Siesta specifically to fire ants. So hopefully your takeaway there is working with BASF, you have everything at your disposal after doing your IPM measures to really go out and succeed in the field. Some of these products you'll notice are in bold. There's a specific reason why. It is that time of year. It is BASF spring promotion. So really excited because a lot of the products that we just mentioned, again, those that specifically were bolded, But then a lot of the products that Fredder is going to give you some tips and tricks on today, on this top row for the termite side, are featured on spring promotion. So after you and your team learn a bit more about these, it's a great chance to go and stock up for the upcoming season on the Trelona, termite baits, Termidor products, and again, many GIC products from the Alpine and Findona family as well. So with that, I believe I'm now going to pass it over to Dr. Fredder. He's going to do our presentation on termite, integrated termite management. If you do have questions, there is a Q&A. There's a Q&A box. I just want to share this really quickly because it has changed from the last time you were on a webinar with us. Look for this box, drop the question in there. As Dr. Fredder wraps up, I'll just kind of moderate and we'll get to as many questions as we can. If for some reason we run out of time, no worries. We can get in contact with you or reach out to your BASF rep. We will make sure we get your question answered one way or the other. So with that, Dr. Fredder, I will pass it over to you.
Hey, thanks a lot, Scott. And thank you everyone for being here today. One thing I do want to mention, I was a little worried because we had a big storm coming through and I was hoping that we don't lose power or internet. But I do want to mention that if in case that ever happens, then we'll try to reschedule the training for another day. So it looks like we're okay today. We had a big storm that just came through and now we're in the clear. I hope we're still in the clear. So with that, let's get started. And when you look at this picture, depending what part of the country you're in, you see some places are just a termite magnet in areas that has very high pressure termite and all that. And I mean, we're going to be talking a lot of things about today about termites specifically, but also I'll try to share with you some of the lessons learned and some of the best practices. As Scott mentioned, this is termite season. So you guys go get them because this is the best time of the year to be able to be out there to capture new accounts actually, and to make sure that you look for those conducive conditions and for activity and entry points and all that that we'll be covering today during our talk for sure. So with that, let me jump in. Let's see, I'm trying to move this forward. It's not going, there you go. So for successful termite control, there's many variables to take that play a big role when we talk about termite control. Termiticide selection being one of them. And when I say termiticide selection, it's not only the AI, the mode of action, but also is the formulation, with formulation type. And of course, homeowner also plays a very important role. You have application methods depending on the product label and all that. We also have a big thing with innovations because we have a lot of new things coming in our pipeline that I'm not going to be spending a lot of time on today, but definitely pay attention to those innovations. Really cool things coming our way. We have building practices, again, sharing lessons learned, best practices, training. What you're doing today is super important. Having the right tools for the job is also very important. Termite species also play a big important role. But the main idea here is our main goal for any termite control program. And I see a lot of confusion out there because many people think it's colony elimination, it's termite elimination. We'll be very lucky if we get termite elimination 100%. So I want to be clear that the main focus, the main goal of any termite control program is structural protection. And we'll get to that in a second. Why does that mean? You know, what that means for you, what it means to the homeowners. So we'll spend a little bit more time on that. But before, I wanted to show you this because fipronil was discovered in 1987. And from the discovery to the time in 2000, when we first launched Termidor, it's been over almost 25 years now. But there's a lot of innovations that have taken place throughout the years. And some of these that you would recognize here on the screen, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on each one of this, But one of the biggest challenges we have when we bring innovations to our industry is when you have a good product already, you know, we always have some hurdles how we can show you and how we can demonstrate that what we created, the new innovation, is even better than the existing product. And it takes many years for PMPs to adopt some of these innovations. Some PMPs jump right into it and they get their hands-on experience with them. Others kind of wait for the other guys to jump in and test first and see how it goes, and then they jump in later. That's fine, but be aware that every time we launch a new product into the market, we have a lot of things in mind, and you are the main focus, our customers, the PMPs, when it comes to all these things that we put out in the market. Now here, I wanted to kind of keep the beginnings of Termidor, but then I added our Trelona, our baiting system. It's been around for actually 20 years now, but along the lines, we've made changes. We made improvements to it, right? So it's no longer that same product that was first launched in 2004. It has gone through a lot of changes. And now when you look at termite control, we're looking for an integrated standpoint, for an integrated perspective. Again, it's not so much about eliminating 100% termite activity. We all wanted to have that, but it's near impossible to achieve that just because of all the things that plays a role into this. But when you look at integrated termite management, I can tell you right now, using these two products, you will probably be able to control 100% all termite activities out there in the field that you're seeing today. But again, there's other products as well in the market, not only from BASF. I also want to mention, as part of our innovation, we have what we call the StationSeeker and the RFID tag. So these are two new innovations that we're introducing into the termite baiting industry that I'll share with you some pictures and some news on that. We're also working on termite remote monitoring. I don't know how many of you guys have heard about this. It's not news anymore, but we're definitely working towards the future on termite control and involves some of these advances in technology, of course. Now, when you look at termite control, and I want to show you this picture of a house and all our products. I'm not asking you guys to use every single product we have in our portfolio against termites to be used in one structure. My message here is that we have plenty of options. We have plenty of tools, not only tools, meaning, you know, a sprayer or a T-handle or a dispersion tip, but tools also referring to as the products. We have many choices that will allow you to get 100% termite control and termite management, in this case that we're referring to, by using either one or a combination of these products you see on the screen. One fact, and these are facts I want to share with you, because we didn't make these claims, and we all know we're number one choice for termite control. We treated over 10 million homes in the U.S. And we also know that, you know, key component in pest control is definitely Termidor, not only for termite control, but also for ant control and spider control and other things that are also on some of our product labels like Termidor SC. But it's extremely effective against a broad range of economically important pests. And we also talk about the non-repellency of the formulation. We have sufficient information and we have sufficient research completed years ago until today to demonstrate the non-repellency properties of the formulation. What it means is undetectable to termites because they have a very acute sense of smell. And we need to make sure that not only the AI, but also the formulation that we develop has these non-repellent properties. We also talk about transfer effect. And some folks call it, other folks call it domino effects in different companies, depending on the pest and depending on the product. But most importantly is you want to shift these when you're dealing with social insects, because you want to have the product that be, it's able to work at very low doses. It has to be slow acting. That way allows for that transfer effect from one individual to the next and inside the nest, inside the colony. And therefore, when you put all these together, the whole goal, like I said before, is that structural protection. To obtain structural protection, it's very important that we follow the label directions. I mean, we're using a product that is so highly effective against termites in this case, that is very forgiving, meaning that there's potential for human errors. There are things that we might not do all the time, or we forgot to do it. There's always all that, but the product, it's always working for you. And again, keep this in mind. These are facts. These are not things we made up. And you can see in the bottom, there's plenty of literature that support each one of these things you see in the screen, each of these properties of the product. And we're going to get into that in a little deeper details here pretty soon. We talk about those 10 million homes being treated with Termidor. And of course, every home is different. Every homeowner is different. Every situation is different. And most importantly is when we deal with these products specifically, it requires digging trenches. It requires drilling. It requires treating to depth. It requires establishing that continuous treatment zone around the foundation of the structure to be successful. So it is not easy. It's difficult to do all these things. It's difficult to create the horizontal and vertical treatment zones. And it's important that we make these precise applications. That's why we have very long label with very specific instructions on how to do these type of treatments. With that being said, it's important that we have a clear objective, which is in many cases determined by the homeowner's needs. So what about the products you're currently using? Let's start talking about some of these things. Can you treat all termite species the same way? And I got your list of termite species on the right. These are the main culprits of all our issues and calls and business opportunities. But you also have drywood termites, damp wood termites, arboreal species, and all that. The answer is no. You cannot treat all species equally the same way. Do all your customers have the same needs? Definitely not. And you need to adjust. You have to listen to the customer needs. You have to adjust to every situation. It requires different set of tool and skills. Are structures built the same way? Definitely not. They are not built the same way. Will the structural design influence termite control? Yes, it will. Are temperature, humidity, climate conditions, time of the year, seasonality important for termite control? You bet it is. What about soil type? Conditions that impact the product selection. I mean, this soil type is also very important. Water content is if soil frozen, is not frozen, depending on what part of the country you're in and the time of the year. So what I'm saying is that can you rely 100% in one product to solve every customer needs? And the answer is no. We all know that. We all know that taking an integrated termite management approach is very important, suited for the needs of those customers that you have. And we'll jump right into this. For a successful structural protection and termite control, you must adopt and maintain what we call an integrated termite management strategy. This includes the selection of the right termiticide. Every time I say selection of the right termiticide, it's also thinking about not only the AI, but also the formulation. I'm going to use a dilutable, or should I use a foam, or should I use a bait, or should I use a combination of any of these is super important. Following label directions, everybody should know by now here in this group that is super important. Using the right tools for the jobs, building, maintaining technical expertise within your company, within your colleagues, Make sure you share those best practices with everybody in your office, because I mean it requires that field knowledge, that experience in the field to be able to become the best termite tech out there. So termite control, again, is never one product solution for all customer needs. And I'm going to keep saying that over and over. When you look at the way homes are built in the U.S., there's a lot of woods, there's a lot of entry points, there's a lot of conducive conditions, especially now with modern homes. There's new building materials being used that sometimes can be a challenge. We'll talk a little bit about that too. Always take an integrated termite management approach. What do I mean with that? I'm not going to spend a lot of time on these, but you guys remember when we talk about IPM, now we're talking about ITM. And we start with inspection, looking for signs of activity, conducive conditions, and all that, interviewing the homeowner, making sure you identify, you know, if there's not only the species you're dealing with, but entry points. Has there been any structural modifications made by the homeowner? Is there any new additions? Then you go into the strategy implementation. Homeowner communication is also very important, especially those documents are legal documents, setting the right expectations, giving instructions, and so on. We definitely, every time we do something, we need to evaluate. Did I follow the label correctly? Did I, you know, do I need to do follow-up inspections? Do I need to adjust the plan? Do I need to, you know, make sure I look at the record keeping and those recommendations? Then when we go into the strategy implementation itself, we always need to target those entry points. And you guys know very well that finding all the entry points is a challenge on itself. Finding those active areas, it's a problem, same thing. Treatment plan, putting together a treatment plan, which highly depends on your termiticide selection. So these two goes hand to hand. And when we look at our own portfolio, when we look at our products, what are the treatment options? And again, I'll be only speaking for the products that we have at BASF, but there's other products as well from our competitors. So keep in mind, keep a broader, mind when you start looking at these things. We have liquid termiticides. We all know there's repellent liquid termiticides, but there's also non-repellent liquid termiticides. There's termite foams, ready to use, or you can mix it with a foaming agent. There's termite baits. These are the chitinthensis as inhibitors. There's borates, there's fumigants, there's termite monitoring nowadays, and all those things. So when you look at our portfolio, you easily recognize some of these products, but we have a lot other products available. Again, only speaking for the products that we do have, but with this list that I'm presenting to you today, with the previous picture I showed you of the house, I can guarantee that you can achieve 100% termite management and control in any situations. You just need to learn when to use one versus the other, or a combination of several products to achieve that goal. So when we look at termite biology, one thing I do want to point out here is that their developmental flexibility. I mean, we have the neotenics, reproductive, primary, secondary, third form of reproductive. They all have the ability to lay the eggs. Just the complexity itself, when you have an egg that develops into a larva and then the worker and nymph. A matter of fact, if you're using repellent products, it kills quick and it kills a lot of workers. The colony has the ability actually, by pheromone signals and communications they develop, in the colony, they can have nymphs reverting back and molting into the work. So they have the ability to replace the worker force within the colony. So it's important that we follow good inspection techniques and all those things. Remember, some depending on the species, actually, I have a note here that it depends on the species. You have certain amount of workers presence and in the colony, but it's all well known and documented that when you use baiting, you're going to see an increase of soldiers visiting the bait stations. And it's a way for the termite to actually, for you to know that the termite colony has taken a toll. Their fitness has been affected. And now, because of the lack of workers and other members in the colony, they're probably sending soldiers out to investigate what's going on, why these guys are not returning back to the colony, or why, what is going on. You're going to see a lot of presence of soldiers when you use baits, for example. This is the part we talk about the reverse molting process. But also, when you look at the colony itself, in the beginning, we all thought, well, maybe you got one or two colonies in your property, and eventually these colonies going to find your house. In reality, what happens is that there could be multiple colonies within a property, and they could be, actually, there's some studies I'm going to show you in a second, because there's been records of many, many colonies per acre. There could be multiple of them. They can be even inside wall voids, up in the attics, inside the wall voids in the house, that you're not even aware they're there until the damage is, until it's too late and there's a lot of damage. But what we're finding is that all these galleries can be interconnected. And what happens is, let's say you eliminate all the colonies but one in this property. Eventually, that colony is going to tap into the same galleries in shelter tube systems, and it's going to end up in the same spot in the house, which for you, it may look like, oh, yeah, the product is no longer working or something happened. It could be a different colony. Once you empty a niche, somebody else will come and occupy that niche. That's why the idea that totally colony control will never, probably will never be achieved, because you will always have somebody moving into that empty niche and occupying that space. That is one of the reasons why our main goal is not to kill 100% all the colonies out there, but it's more like structural protection. We want to make sure the homeowners, those structures, your customers are well protected. So, for example, I'm going to give you this example. I had a lot of experience when I was out west in Arizona with heterothermes. I got a good picture here, Paul Baker. Very common to see these vast networks of tubes going everywhere. And very common to see those stalactites coming in the desert. If you've been in the desert, if you're in the desert region of the U.S., there are not many big trees. So these termites are programmed to constantly search for food. And different from some other species here on the East Coast, these termites like to nibble. They're very skittish. They nibble a little bit on a piece of 2x4. They know it's there. They move somewhere else, and they do that throughout the house. They can actually travel very long distances. And they have different behaviors when it comes to those different species. And that's why I wanted to show this, because it's a very common thing to happen in the desert environments, like in Phoenix, like some parts of California, New Mexico. Some of these termites actually will pop in different regions, different places around the house. And it's what we call termite chasing, because then the PMPs go crazy, got termites in one room, and then the next 3 months later is another room. And that's some of the challenges we've seen depending on the species. Now, there's one study at Vargo did here locally in Raleigh, North Carolina, where he found a range of colonies within an acre. And the average, actually, in this particular study was 23 colonies per acre. So can you imagine how many homes, at least in these suburbs areas, you can put four houses easily, if not more, in many places in an acre. If you go to a downtown area, definitely you're going to have a lot more homes. Lots are probably smaller. But think about it. You put four or five structures in 1 acre, and then you add 23 colonies on average. There's data that it shows over 100 different colonies in 25 acres and things like that. So again, keep in mind how this adds to the complexity of termite control. Now, when we look at their behavior, we also talk about that repellency properties. What is a repellent versus a non-repellent product? A good example of these pyrethroids. Pyrethroids, definitely they kill termites. And but one thing is that pyrethroids create what is called a barrier. So in this situation, and this was an arena where termites actually were released, and there was a pyrethroid treatment with a gap that was left on purpose. And then we added a piece of wood on this corner of the arena to be able to see how termites interact with a treated barrier, in this case created by a pyrethroid. As you can see here, I don't know which direction they started going first, but at some point they came up and they touched that treated barrier. And you notice that they backed up immediately. Remember, these organisms, termites, are very well adapted to detect minute amount of chemicals because they use pheromones for communication. So they can easily detect repelling insecticides in the soil, and they try to avoid it until they find a gap. When they find a gap on that treatment, they're capable of going through and recruiting more termites going in that direction. And then now they're feeding on your house or your customer home. Now, it's different when we talk about Termidor and some other products that are actually also non-repellent, but specifically we did study with this study with Termidor, same arena. So we released the termites again. You can see how they started going up again. They were not able to detect the treatment zone. Be mindful that I said treatment zone. I did not say treatment barrier or barrier. Now it's a treatment zone because they are not able to detect it and became a killer zone that now actually was able to control that colony. Even when we had a gap, they still be able to walk right through it and pick up a lethal dose, take it back to the colony, and now your home is intact and is well protected. And that's the whole basics. Again, I'm putting this here because this is a study coming out of the University of Florida. Dr. Phil Culler actually did this study, and it's been well documented throughout the years. Remember, almost 25 years of termite control using Termidor. And you can see here the differences between one and the other. But there's been other studies also conducted. And in this case, you can see an area that was treated here with Termidor. And now you can see how the termites in the video are able to penetrate that treatment zone with Termidor. So that proves right there that termites cannot detect the product. The product is non-repellent. And I say no repellent, as you always keep in mind that all these studies were done following label directions. So you have to stick to those concentrations that are on the label. And when you do the treatment per label directions, termites will not be able to detect any of these products in the soil. And therefore, you know, controls the colony. So when we look at the behavior, now let's talk a little bit about transfer effect and why termites need to do transfer of fluids, and then we'll get to that in a second. But when you look at termites, are close relative of some of cockroaches, actually, and there's some wood cockroaches that actually have a protozoan in their gut that helps them digest cellulose. Of course, in the gut of termites, as they feed also wood, they need to have symbiotic organisms, in this case protozoan, but also there's bacteria and other things that actually help the digestion of cellulose in the case of termites. And this protozoan, I'm going to show you a picture here of what they look like. You can see in the pictures down below, when they puncture the gut of a termite, you can see the release of all these protozoans. But again, there's a whole range of microorganisms that together help them the digestion of cellulose. Now, one thing I do want to point out is they produce high levels of volatiles and some oleic and fatty acids and things like that. And I'll get back to that in a second because it's super important to understand that part. Because when you look at entomology, when you look at insects, you cannot look at them alone, meaning that there's a whole range of microorganisms associated with these insects that has a very important role in their life, in this case, digestion of cellulose, but at the colony level, and we'll get to that in a second here. One way that we obtain transfer effect using Termidor is by the natural behavior that they use mutual grooming. They clean each other. As you can see in this picture, you can see one individual cleaning the antenna of the other individuals here. You can see, clearly see it right there. And we take advantage of that because if one individual touches, one individual that came in contact with Termidor touches this other individual in the colony, and this mate has the ability to transfer a lethal dose to those individuals as well. Now, they do trophallaxis, and again, they have to do trophallaxis because they need to have that bacteria, those protozoan in their guts to be able to digest cellulose. So you quickly saw on that video how two termites were regurgitating their gut content, and they were doing trophallaxis, tomorial trophallaxis. But when you see the clock here coming up to 33, you're going to see real quick how the proctorial trophallaxis take place. You can see one termite going behind the other termite and picking up a fecal droplet. And of course, they do all this because they, again, require those protozoans to be able to digest and survive, to digest cellulose and survive. Now, when you look at this, they also do necrophoresis. It's like ants. These are all social insects. And ants, they take their dead and they move it. They move it away from the colony. They push it outside or they push it into a chamber that actually they, in a way, they do burials because they sometimes seal these chambers. Now, I do want to mention that there's a couple papers that talks about how their microorganisms and their gut releasing all these volatiles, all these fatty acids, actually triggers that burial behavior on the termites. So it's not uncommon to see places where you have high mortality of termite workers, where the remaining of the colony decide to seal off and bury those individuals that are being affected. And in the process, actually, by moving the dead and doing all these behaviors, they also do necrophagy. They eat the dead because they have to have, their colony has to be clean. These are organisms that live in the soil with bacteria, with funguses and fungi and all that. And they are actually need to be able to clean their colony. They clean their nest mates and all that to avoid any of these problems. And that's one way they do it. And another way, they actually acquire a lethal dose of Termidor. They also do cannibalism. So you can see here some individuals are still moving, they're still alive, but you can see how the other individual starts eating their abdomen from the back. And they do that, they don't start with the head. Usually the head is a little bit more sclerotized and harder, but they also go to the most nutritious part of the body, which is the abdomen, where they have all the protozoans and all those good bacteria they need. So that's why it's important that they do that as well. And we take advantage of all these things. There's also other studies done that actually looked at, you know, painting the termites different colors. And one group is exposed and then is put with another group of a different color. And you can actually follow, you can trace the transfer effect from red to yellow to white. This has been documented multiple times in literature in our industry. And it's a fact that this takes place. Same thing that takes place with ants. And that's something important to understand. Again, nobody's making these things up. This has been documented extensively. So when we look at that home picture that I showed you earlier that has all the products in there, let's talk a little bit about construction practices, because this is super important for everybody to understand. I mean, we built homes where termites are. That's a no-brainer. They're very cryptic by nature. They work 24/7. They're always hungry. They forage through shelter tubes. They will die if they get exposed to heat and sunlight. I mean, we all know all these things. It's important when you're doing those home inspections that you point out all these conducive conditions, because it's super important. Remember, they can travel long distances. And then if you put 4 to 5 homes or more in an acre, and then you add all these conducive conditions, and then you add 23 on average colonies, all this could become a problem pretty easy. So make sure you do a proper inspection when you're out there looking for termite activity, inspecting those homes. This is another suggestion I have for you, and I've done this in the past. I got some funny stories about it, but whenever you have an opportunity to actually get out to a site where there's new buildings being built, put together in different stages of constructions, I do highly recommend that you get out there, take a look. You can take some pictures and all that, but make sure you get familiarized with the terminology, how things look inside a wall, because this will help you a lot when it comes to termite control, because you kind of start understanding where things are, where entry points might be located at. But I highly recommend that doing that is super important. One advice is, if you're going to one of these sites, and I had situations where I show up dressed with long sleeve and a hard hat, and I would put all the construction workers running because they think is an inspector on site. So never do that. Always introduce yourself. I'm here. I'm curious. I want to see how you guys do it. There might be restrictions in certain places that you cannot be on site, but at least approach them, introduce yourself, and you might actually benefit from really good information. Never sneak up on them wearing long sleeve and a hard hat, as I did before. It's a lot of fun, though. Construction joint types. This is another topic that I wanted to discuss today, because I've learned quite a bit here. And I looked at the American Concrete Institute about what is a construction joint and how many types there are. And these are some of the main ones that you guys have seen. Most importantly is, once a house is built, it's finished, and up the wall is up and the floor is down, then you don't see those expansion construction joints. And I keep saying construction joints. I need to train myself to use that terminology, because we always say expansion joints, or we say cold joints. Let's explain that. So we are all familiar with contraction joints. Good example is sidewalks. So these are actually cuts. These are places where a groove in the concrete is created to form a weak point, a weak plane. And what it allows to do is, when concrete cracks, it regulates the direction and the location of the cracking. That way you don't have a nice patio with cracks going all over the place. So that's the reason why sidewalks, we use a lot of these contraction joints. But you also have isolation joints. This is typical in a garage, when you have a pier or a beam that is surrounded, as you see here, by these isolation joint, because when folks drive on those parking garages or streets, the concrete moves. And if you have like the picture on the right, which is an electrical box, you don't want those vibrations to transfer to the electrical box or to the pier of a parking garage. So therefore, the term isolation joints. All these are ways termites can get into the structure. We all know that, but there's other type of joints as well. We have the expansion joints. Many of the expansion joints are filled with material. They're usually flexible. Many times is wood-based products, so it's food for termites. A loud movement due to dimensional increases and reduction, like contraction and expansion, very common on driveways to see these type of construction and expansion joints specifically. And lastly, the cold join, because we love the term cold join. Cold join is not other thing that when concrete truck comes in, dumps all the concrete, and then the second truck is taking too long. That first pour starts curing. When the second truck comes in, if they waited too long, if it was a day it was dry and too hot, what happens is when they pour the second truck of concrete, you will never get 100% bonding of the two surfaces. Therefore, it's going to create that cold join that you see here on the pictures. You can easily see it here, but you can also see it here. So it could be on the verticals, but also horizontal surfaces when concrete is poor and you don't get that proper bonding. Therefore, another entry point for termites. So be aware of those things. We also have monolithic slabs. We all know that it's a one pour slab type of slab. You have a lot of utility lines, plumbing penetrations going through here. Entry points are usually those utility lines, plumbing penetrations, or the outside of the slab. Many times you're going to have this sign on the garage, do not drill, because you don't want to cut through those post-station cables. And it will affect actually integrity of the foundation. But what happens is when these are built, many wood products are being used, wood stakes and boards and all that to hold the concrete in place. But if you look at this picture, number one, you have those plumbing penetrations. You also have some back here. But if you look at this number four, there's a wooden stake that is holding the rebar or the post-tension cables, whatever is there, it's holding it. Now, the question is, do you think the builders are going to remove these stakes once the concrete is poured? I bet that the answer is no. But not only that, if they remove it, well, they're going to create a huge hole on the middle of the house. So most of the time, they're left behind. And that's perfect entry points. You can see now here, number four again. You can see the top of that stake actually sticking out. There's another one, and you have all these plumbing penetrations going through the foundation in that particular case. But you also have all these wood pieces and, you know, part of the structure that was used during the pour. Many times they get left behind as well. Again, we talk about all these plumbing penetrations and bath traps, and we're going to get to that in a second because it's super important for termite control. Now, when we have a floating slab, again, remember those two trucks. When concrete cures, then you cannot bond it anymore with a second pour. And this is exactly what happens here. But in this case, the footer of the home is always in the floating slab laid out first. And then days later, whenever the next step is taking place, the slab is poured next, and you will never get perfect bonding of the two. That's why you see sometimes huge gaps in between the two. Again, the entry points is also, highlighted here in red. You have the entire perimeter of that footer, interior perimeter of the footer, as an possible entry point for termites. And when you see the cross section here, you can easily see where the red is, places termites can get in. You also have these gaps, we already talked about it, but also you have inherited, you're going to have cracks on concrete. You cannot get away from those. You will always have cracks in concrete, and you can see some example of those there. Supported slab, in this case, are many times they use hollow blocks to build a perimeter, and then they pour the slab on top. It could be fully supported or partially supported, like in this picture here on the bottom, and I'm going to show you the differences. What is more important is that there's plenty of entry points for termites to get into the structure. So watch out for those, because those are the biggest challenges when it comes to termite control. Again, you see in red all the potential entry points for this. You can see a fully supported slab here showing in red entry points, but also could be partially supported like this one in the picture that allows entry of termites straight into the wall void. And you guys don't, or the homeowners don't even see it until it's too late. So keep those things in mind, especially older homes and places like that. They use a lot of hollow block, even newer homes. I'll get to that in a second one. This is a good example here of a sill plate that actually got eaten up by termites that came through the hollow block. You can see it here. So again, good. We have plenty of examples to demonstrate that this is a hotspot for termites to get in. Basements, depending what part of the country you're in, you're going to have a lot of basements. They pose different challenges because you have utility lines, you have these windows, you have all the problems with poor concrete that could have all those cold joints we talked about. Crawl space, you have different set of challenges here because those piers and beams can be made of different materials and sometimes can be hollow blocks as well, creating a bigger problem. Same diagram here that you've seen before, a lot of hollow block being used. When you look at this, you have the exterior wall, pipes, piers, things you have to pay attention to, piers and beams, actually, porches and patio inside the hollow blocks. All these are important to look at. You have a situation here where a lot of termite damage was captured there. You can have a, this is a whole, really thick shelter tube, mud tube going up into the house. You have a situation here, you have another one here. So, and these are the visible ones that you can see. So make sure you do proper inspections when you're doing a crawl space inspection or home. Again, those piers and beams can be made of different materials. I've even seen wooden piers just sitting in the ground in Hawaii, for example. That's asking for trouble. I know those homeowners are going to get termites if they don't have it already. So make sure you, you point those things out to the homeowners and you make sure you're aware of them. Now, when it comes to a crawl space, sometimes it's required actually to trench and treat the inside of that crawl space. Many times requires you drilling. You have to make sure that you remove any debris, any materials from inside the crawl space. And many construction companies use it as a dump ground to get rid of stuff they don't want to pick up and throw it away. So make sure that you pay attention to those things. And to make things even more complicated, nowadays you have the sealed crawl spaces. And if you look at this part here, there should be a gap that is shown here. There should be a gap. That's many times the only gap you have to do the termite inspection and to make sure that that you're doing proper inspection. You have to crawl all the way through the crawl space, use mirrors and things like that to make sure that you're not missing, because it's a very small gap to be able to determine the entry points of termites in some situations. Of course, you have the bath trap, and keep saying plumbing penetrations, bath traps, and so on. They count for 50% of all termite entry points into the structure. So please make sure that you're doing those proper inspections. Nowadays, you don't need to open a big, opening on the wall, because nowadays you can just drill a tiny hole and use a borescope from Lowe's or Home Depot to do a proper inspection. Not many homeowners, as we all know, will allow you to open up a wall and be able to do that, unless if they have termites. And then you can do that. And of course, you have to make sure you treat it, depending on the product, using the right amount of product. So keep those things in mind. Just to wrap this part of the talk, how to overcome some of the challenges is you've got to make sure you do all these things. You have to inspect your equipment. You have to make sure you calibrate it, do safety checks, preview the work order and graph, inspect the sites, look for those utility lines, entry points. You need to know where the main water shutoff valve is, because if you've been long enough doing termite control, sooner or later, you know you're going to drill a pipe at some point. I've never done that. That's not true. But you have to make sure you develop a plan. You take into account all these things and revise the plan, making sure you know which product selection you're using, concentration, volume, all that. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on all these things, but most importantly, make sure the diagram your development is legible. This diagram here made by Julian Yates, it's very detailed. You can read everything. It looks busy, but when you get closer to it, there's every single detail on this map and this diagram, and that's what I want you guys to do, because sooner or later, this might be a legal document that you have to present in court. You may have to make sure everybody's able to read it. So some of the challenges also, we talk about the equipment, and we talk about calibrating. There's a bucket method that I'm going to show you in a second. Of course, you can count, but I know how you guys do termite treatments, and you might be applying the product, and all of a sudden somebody calls you, you're on the phone, and all those things actually affect how much product you're putting out. We would like you to put out more, but it's not necessarily better, as we learned already, and we talked about it. Having a flow meter is also very important, but remember, flow meters need calibration and maintenance as well, and they're not cheap. So let's jump onto the bucket method, because this is something anybody in this talk today can do today at home, or you could do it on your job site, or you could do it in the office. But make sure you follow these steps when you're calibrating using the bucket method. And I'm going to show you some calculations on how you can make these calculations. Again, this is the way I do it. When I was training termite techs, I wanted to find an easy way to actually explain this math behind these calculations. And I think there's a pretty easy way looking at this animation here. So let's say it took 80 seconds to get 4 gallons, and that's what I do here. So I need to determine how many seconds, in 60 seconds, how many gallons. So I multiply the diagonal divided by 80, which is outside, and I get 3 gallons per minute. But now I can calculate how many seconds it takes me to put out 1 gallon. And I do the same, multiply the diagonal, divided whatever is outside, in this case 4, we get 20 seconds per gallon. So that's a very easy way to do this bucket method. Anybody can do it. Also, when we look at, what are the differences between Termidor HE, conventional versus EPLI, I mean, I have to admit that we don't have the shortest label out there. It's pretty long, very detailed. But we have a lot of training opportunity with our local sales reps, with our tech team, and please reach out if you have questions. But it's important when using Termidor HE, in this case, you have to put 4 gallons every 10 linear feet. Based on our calibration, it's 0.4 gallons. So when you do all this math and going down to 4 feet, you're putting a lot of volume. And I hope you guys are doing this, because again, it's on the label, and you have to make sure you abide by that label, is the law. So in the case of HE, it's a little bit different, because now you have 18-inch centers holes or drill holes, and then you have to put 2 gallons every 10 linear feet, which means 0.29 gallons per hole per foot of depth. And in this case, going down to 2 feet deep, you only need 4 gallons to be able to treat with Termidor HE. So there's a substantial differences between these two in why HE will have an advantage over Termidor HE. If you remember, the trenching part is also very important. Please don't skip this part. I've been in situations where the PMPs decide not to trench. It's Friday, it's afternoon, it's super hot. I'm gonna skip the trenching, I'm just gonna rot. Not a good practice, it's not on the label. Always treat to the top of the footer, never treat below the bottom of the footer. But you have to make sure you treat to depth. Again, we talked earlier about how forgiving the product is because it works at very low parts per million. But again, we have to make sure we treat per label requirements. Now, when we look at the industry standard termiticides, you apply it into the soil profile and you're going to have a gradient. So it's not going to be heavily concentrated. It's going to have a gradient of product. Then when HE is applied because of the technology behind the formulation, gravity actually allows to pull that product and evenly distribute HE within the soil profile. Again, when you do termite treatments, you don't get the high concentration all the time from the top inches to the bottom inches. You always have a gradient. And that's super important because, as a product is dose dependent, it could have a negative impact. When some of the lab studies out there, you have to make sure they treat it properly and they use the right amount of product. So again, when we look at this, this is a pre-construction. You have the plumbing penetrations. And now, of course, you're going to have to treat around those plumbing penetrations. So you have to focus on those areas. But then you will also have to treat the inside, the vertical, and the horizontal spaces of the foundation of the structure, as shown here. And that is required when you're doing the pre-construction part of the treatment here. I'm going to try to speed up this a little bit here because we don't have a whole lot of time. I want to make sure I stick to my time, but since this is our own training, I wanted to make sure we spend a little bit more time so you guys understand this part of the training. Again, when you look at conventional treatment, you always have to wrap around the house. You have to drill those dirt field porches. You have to drill the budding slabs. When you're doing the conventional treatment, you have to do everything that is in the conventional section of the label, which includes drilling, trenching inside the coral space, treating all of those plumbing penetrations, and wall voids if you have hollow block foundations types of building. Now, by following the exterior perimeter localized interior type of treatment section, is a section of the label, we cut back on the amount of work that you have to do to get the same results as a conventional treatment. There's always exceptions to the rules depending where you are. The EPLI section of the label is the minimum that you could do, but you could go beyond that if you need to. But research has demonstrated doing this is the minimum that allows you to get the efficacy that you always get by following the conventional part of the label. Why is this? It's because of the technology on HE. So when the product is mixed in the tank, actually the Termidor, the fipronil molecules are surrounded by these micelles. The micelles are negatively charged. And because soils is also negatively charged, they repel. And gravity actually pulls these molecules and evenly distributing the product. And this is not only happening vertically, but also horizontally too. And that's why we have 18-inch centers for HE and so on. But the whole idea is you want to get the dispersion, even distribution of those molecules. Again, when you do this type of treatment, nothing is concentrated in one tiny spot. It's evenly distributed throughout. And that's important because these micelles eventually go away and they create a uniform distribution of the molecules, creating what we call the enhanced protection zone around the structure. Keep in mind, it's a protection zone, it's not a barrier. Here's another video that demonstrates the differences between the two products. If I let run this video, you'll see that the product HE starts coming out of the wax cup. And that tells you the power of Termidor HE technology. There are polymers on the formulation that allows for that penetration through the wax cup. You will be asking yourself, why do you show me a wax cup? I will never treat a wax cup, but it's a very good visual to show you this. Because when you do the same with a mud tube, remember this is put together by termites using saliva and soil particles, And when you look at the differences between one and the other, I can definitely see a difference that HE is moving fast. It's actually creating that penetration into the mud tube. So think along the lines, if I'm applying HE in a foam formulation, for example, inside a wall void, or if I'm treating a soil, this will be easily taken up into these mud tubes, into the soil, and then increase chances of termites coming in contact with the product. And that's the whole key. We want to make sure termites come in contact with the product. Now, I'm going to jump into this because I want to talk a little bit about termite baiting, and I want to make sure I get to all my points here. But again, we are all familiar with Trelona being a chitin synthesis inhibitor. It's a great fit for an integrated termite management approach. Inhibits the chitin formation. Therefore, when the insects molt, and these only take place when they molt, so they can be exposed to the product for a certain amount of time, but it will never have an effect until the insect molts. And when they molt, actually, the cuticles not form properly. And what they do is they just, bleed to death. They dry out. They cannot survive because they cannot form that exoskeleton, the cuticle on the exoskeleton. And that's how it works. But then when we look at our product, what is truly Trelona? It's not only the AI, it's not only the matrix that is associated with it, it's not only the design of the cartridge, but it's also the design of the station itself. We want it to be low profile. We use pure cell matrix, pure cellulose, actually in these tablets. We want to make sure with those vertical slits that we increase this wood to soil contact or in this case, cartridge to soil contact, because it allows the termites to easily and more easily find these stations. These stations are a little wider. They have these ridges and these vertical slits for all that. We had a cap that we have a tool that actually opens up those caps. With Trelona annual, you get double the amount of product. So we're talking about 248 grams total of product in one station. I do want to show you this picture because if you recall, for some of you who've been around for some time, we used to have the wood, the termite monitoring base made of wood that will be inserted first, and then you will have a cartridge on top. This could be direct baiting with one cartridge or monitoring only with no AI. But what I wanted to capture on this image is the fact that you can see how the soil is brought in and it makes a close contact with, whether being the wood or the cartridge itself, as you see here. And what you see here on top of the cartridge, by the way, I don't know if you notice, it's termites. So when you put a cartridge on top of the other, the cartridge's bottom has some feet, leaving some gap, space, that allows, entice the termites actually to go and investigate. And because it has holes on top and on the bottom, they can easily access the inside of the cartridge that way. So I wanted to share those images, and I got plenty more where we've seen, you can see in the left two images, you have Cultotermes formosanus. We found actually a queen in this situation living inside the cartridge. On the right, the top two pictures, you have Reticulitermes species there. And you can see how they're very comfortable living inside these cartridges and consuming these bait matrix. So we have plenty of pictures to demonstrate that, no doubt. And again, you can see in the bottom part, you can see the holes on the top of the cartridge. And on the left picture, you can see the holes on the bottom. This is our product. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that other than I'm going to get to that in a second, but I wanted to make sure to show you that Trelona annual has two cartridges. When you have two cartridges in all the stations around the structure, you can do a year inspection. Let's say you install in May, you go back the next May to do the first inspection. Of course, you can inspect earlier if you want to, if you choose to. But the whole idea is you have within those 30 days from the year, you need to do the first inspection. And main point is never to exceed 15 months. Keep that in mind. Also, when we do the installs of termite baits around the home, it's super important that we just don't drop it. I've seen folks like measuring 15 feet, 10 feet, 20 feet, and they put a stake or they put the station in there or a flag to mark it, and you go to the house, it's perfect. Everything is symmetrical. But in reality, you have to look for those conducive conditions. You have to make sure that you follow the label, but there's certain recommendations for areas with high termite pressure that I will pay attention to. You have exceptions like a driveway or a patio. You could go beyond the 30 feet. I mean, not beyond the 30 feet, but within the 30 feet. You have to place in 2 to 3 feet from the foundation of the structure. Always avoid placing under the roof drip line of the structure. All those things are super important. Now, we talk about the Station Seeker, and I want to make sure I show you this because pretty exciting news. The new Trelona annual boxes are going to come with this symbol that you see here, and this symbol is an RFID symbol. Whenever you buy our product, the new product is going to have those on the boxes, which means is that it's going to have the RFID tag on the lid already installed on that kit. And what allows you to use is that Station Seeker to be able to find them when they're buried under mulch or rock covers, like in many places in Arizona, some places in California as well. And we do have a lot of mulch here on the East Coast and throughout the country. So it is a nice tool to have. You don't have to use it at every station. I don't want you to go around with this thing all around it. You just have to use it. You have to bring your diagram into the field. And when you don't find that one station that is always a pain in the neck, it's when you pull it out and make sure you work that out pretty quick from that point on. I want to show you, this is how me holding the unit on the left, and on the right, I'm actually doing the scanning. You can see how it's picking up a tag number on buried under the mulch there. Also, we always talk about above ground termite activity, and this not only applies to termite baiting, but also applies to all the other termiticide products that we just talked about. There will be situations where you need to tackle the above ground termite activity quickly and fast. Not every homeowner is the same, and I wanted to point that out because some folks might not like having above ground stations in a nice home like this, for example. There's other options that we offer. And of course, when it comes to these things, all these things comes to mind. Using the right tools, using the right product, we saw the power of Termidor HE. And of course, we have the alternative of ready-to-use foams like Termidor and Alpine. We have a lot of equipment that there are out there, good equipment that you can use. And it's important that you reach out to your distribution partner, to your reps, depending on which company you want to use. Foams can be, you can create foams, what we call dry foams or wet foams, depending on the ratio. Of course, if you want to treat voids where no soil is below, or if you have an electric outlet below, I want you to stick to a drier foam. And you want to avoid those areas, or actually one good recommendation is turning off the power to if you're working near an electric outlet and using foams. But again, there's opportunity to use one or the other depending on what you want to use. Always make sure you use the diluted material, never the concentrate. Make sure you use a foaming agent. Make sure that foaming agent must be non-repellent as well. And most importantly, you have to make sure you read and follow the label directions for that foaming agent. I'm going to leave it like that because there's other products in the market. Also, you have to make sure you agitate often. You have to make sure you measure correctly so you get that expansion ratio that you want to get at. When using the tools, make sure you use dispersion tips to get you the penetration, the ability to get to those tight spaces. I'm just going to give you a Termidor foam example. The picture on the left is not showing Termidor foam example, but I wanted you to see what the dispersion of the foam looks at inside a wall void. The whole idea is use the tools that you have available at your disposal to get the best treatment options for this. Using wood injection is also very important. You can use different equipment. You can use foaming agents as well. It is a very good challenge, actually, a big challenge when you have 2x4s like this being built and usually at the round door frames that are sandwiched together. As you can see here, there's like 7 2x4s here, which makes it very hard. Some of these places may actually require you to have an access point to be able to treat in between those structural elements. Now, when it comes to some of these, I do mention all the time, make sure the foaming agents or the ready-to-use products must be non-repellent. They need to work slow, at low dosages, to allow transfer. And in this case, these are two water-based products that we have that everybody's familiar with. But I wanted to show you this because I'm going to speed these up. Because you can see the foam coming. If this was a repellent product, termites will be running all over the place. They know physically there's a foam, something coming my way, they don't know what it is, and they send an alarm. That's why you see now the soldiers coming to inspect what's going on. And you can see actually one of the soldiers here takes a chunk of the foam. They don't know what it is, but I can guarantee this is a non-repellent foam. In this case, Termidor foam or PT Alpine foam. Again, there's different options out there. It's great for spot treatments, great for those above ground supplemental treatment options. It works faster when using baits, and it's compliant with our Termidor 10-year pledge and all that. So keep those things in mind. I really want to skip through some of these important things because I'm about to finish. I don't want to hold you up any longer. But we've done a lot of studies about the structure of that foam. We wanted to make sure that over time it lasts because you want to make sure that that foam is absorbed into the wood or coating the inside of the wall void. And as you can see with our product, Termidor foam, took 18 hours actually for it to completely collapse. And this is with an open container. Now, when we do that side by side with one of the competitors out there, you can quickly see that it doesn't take long. 30 minutes versus 18 hours is the difference. And then when you put this into a wall void, this is the same result, same pattern that you will see when using against a competitor. Again, you want that to hold up. You want that to be absorbed into the wood. You want that product to coat slowly the inside of the wall void. 3 hours later, everything is gone. And you can see here now, this is a closed wall void imitation to show you which product do I want to use. I know for a fact that I want to stick with Termidor foam. Also keep in mind all this water dripping down, if it gets into electrical outlet, will be a big problem. With that, I know it's taking longer than what I expected, but I always read and follow the label directions. I hope you really learned something important today. With that, I will be happy to answer any questions if we have time. I know we're tight on time here.
Thank you, Dr. Frutter, and great job. A lot of good information, really nice visuals. So glad that everyone was able to stick around. And again, this will be emailed out to the attendees afterwards so that you can rewatch or share as needed, along with the winner of our prizes. So remember, three lucky folks will get Yeti tumblers. So keep an eye on your email. We do have a few questions, Dr. Frutter, some good questions too. So we'll see if we can get to all of these. The first one, excuse me. So one attendee mentioned that they went to a home that had an active infestation of Formosan termites. They noticed the home had been treated sometime in the past. The entire shower and shower pan had to be ripped out due to water leakage. All the damaged wood was removed and they treated the entire area with Termidor foam. Additionally, they trenched both sides of the corner of the home and installed a bait station. So The question is there anything else you would have recommended being done? Does that sound pretty comprehensive? What's your thoughts on that treatment plan?
That definitely sounds very comprehensive treatment there. I'm curious to know where part of the country you're in, what situation there was. I've done that before where we use a combination of our products. Again, I always tell PMPs is if you're not getting the results you want, it could be that there's a lot of termite pressure, new colonies moving in, but also it could be the fact that somehow you missed the entry point. Sooner or later, they're going to come in contact with one of the products, one of the applications. But it's important to understand that they need to be in contact with the product. And it's also important that this is an ongoing battle that is, again, it's not 100% termite control. It's actually integrated termite management and keeping those at bay and the structural protection that you want. So, yes, I think you've done plenty. And I would suggest if you still have issues at that particular structure, please reach out to our sales rep or our tech reps. It will be able actually to provide more hands-on training or actually on-site training if needed.
Thanks, Rutter. Excuse me, you mentioned geography. I believe that question came from Texas, so a spot you know very well. And it sounds like they did a comprehensive treatment, but as Fredder mentioned, please reach out if you would like to contact one of our tech folks or sales reps. They'd be happy to discuss further as well.
I would say just reach out to Ronnie Holder.
There you go. Calling him out. All right. Colleen had a question on pre-construction treatments. Do the technicians typically fill the voids if they see them? So I think back to the section where you were mentioning pre-construction.
So when it comes to pre-construction treatments, and I'm trying to figure out which voids are you referring to. So make sure when you're doing pre-construction that you have the horizontal, right? So usually you look at a square footage, and then, but you also have the verticals. So you have to make sure that you get the proper treatment. And then once the final grade is put on that structure, then you're going to have to come back and do the final grade. But don't do the final grade has to be completed because you don't want to create gaps in that treatment. So in particular, while those voids, I mean, it's if you know this is going to be a crawl space where there's hollow blocks and there's voids, it would probably be a very good practice if you're in a high termite pressure area to get some products there. You don't have to, but again, I would focus more on those plumbing penetrations around the structure. I think we will be better off that way. But always make sure you follow the label directions. Super important when it comes to these treatments. So make sure that you're doing it correctly.
Yeah, and Frederick, you mentioned there's a very comprehensive and specific section of those labels for pre-construction mm-hmm. as well. So always worth a good review as well. I think we have one more, Fredder. It's a good question as well. So Mike is asking, if you have active termites and use the Trelona baits, how soon should you go back to check? So it sounds like you install at the time of an active infestation. Maybe speak to Fredder what the label requires and if you have any recommendations above and beyond that as well.
Yeah, that's a great question. So we know If you're using Trelona annual, remember it has two cartridges in it. So there's plenty to kill multiple colonies, no doubt. And what I probably would do in those situations, I know that when we put these in the ground, they will last up to a year, depending on the termite pressure and all that. I would definitely consider probably waiting 3 months in these situations to go back. Again, if you have the two cartridges per station, there's no rules on how soon you can go back. The only thing is keep in mind that if you start inspecting multiple times and soon, then you're creating a disturbance that it will not work in your favor, because termites don't like being disturbed, and they might abandon the place. Eventually, they're going to come back to it. But I would at least give it 120 days and check and see how much termite activity there is. It's likely that you will still have product left. And but again, just follow, we have a best practice technical information bulletin that talks about when to change the cartridges, and that will give you also some good information about that, because then you can look and see, okay, I have 2/3 of the consumption already, so I'll go ahead and add new ones. But then if you have, you know, one cartridge left, you don't have to replace that one, or you can just refill the other one, but leave the other one alone. Remember, the other thing is, the longer you keep those cartridges in the soil, in the environment, the more attractive will become to termites, because of funguses and bacteria and all these microorganisms will start try to break down the product, and actually makes it even better for termites. So yeah, good question. I would say 120 days, but again, don't overdo it.
Yeah, good stuff. We did get Ray specified. He's in Fort Worth, so shout out to Fort Worth, Texas. And Colleen also mentioned the voids, just to specify on her question. She was referring to the voids from the concrete pouring issues that can occur.
Okay. Yeah, so basically when you're doing the pre-treat, remember, you don't have the concrete pour yet. So it's super important that you do the horizontals treatments. And then when the concrete is poured on top, you already have the treatment in place. And guys, I need to mention this because I've seen these. Don't treat ever on top of the plastic. Many times they lay down plastic. Make sure the product gets to the soil, not on top of the plastic. So that's a hard thing, is coordinating with the builder, making sure they haven't gotten to that stage yet, where you can actually do the treatment on the soil. But again, after you have a post-construction, that it's very common on the dirt-filled porch, for example, for the soil to settle, and then you have these huge voids and gaps underneath the slab. And in those cases, you want to drill. You want to drill, use a 360 or a 180 dispersion tip. You can use foaming agents, to make sure that you get that horizontal dispersion in the wall and in the void underneath this slab. Good question. Yeah.
Yeah, great question. Thanks, Colleen, for specifying that. And thank you, Kevin from Moxie Pest Control in Kansas City. We appreciate you joining and for the kind words. One other question, and Fred, or maybe I can start on this one. JD was asking about, we mentioned our above ground solutions, if BASF would potentially be developing above ground bait. I'll start by saying, you know, Fred, you kind of showed our innovation timeline. And, you know, one of the things that excites me about always being at BASF is Termidor is a great example. We launched this fantastic industry changing product, but we never rested on that. And we continue to innovate with label updates, with new formulations and application changes. Hopefully you all are seeing we're doing a similar thing on our baiting side, where going from advanced to Trelona annual and RFID and a lot of the other fun stuff that's coming out. We're always looking at different solutions to serve customers. That being said, anything, you know, that is being developed or looked at always takes time. So I would encourage anyone, really look at Fredder's information again on the above ground solutions that exist today. I think sometimes there is a perception that maybe certain technologies are needed when there's some really nice chemistries like Termidor foam and Alpine foam, or even using HE through a foaming agent like Fredder mentioned, that can get the job done. They can employ the power of Termidor and be a little bit less disruptive to the homeowner. So I would say, you know, we have always our eye to the market to see what's next, but also a lot of cool stuff out on the market today for those above ground infestations to use along with the chemistries that you're using in ground.
Right. No, that's a good good answer there, Scott. I mean, with all the tools we have, I have no doubt that we have a solution for almost every problem, but you have to know which tools are you going to use, which products, and how you're going to use it. And that's the hardest part. And I'm saying this, but you guys remember, you're not alone on these. Reach out to the sales rep, reach out to your tech reps, our tech reps. And the more you learn, the better. But yeah.
Rutter, another question, and this is a great one. Carl has asked about bait efficacy, and specifically you mentioned degradation, mold, different things that can happen within bait cartridges. Maybe speak to how that can impact effectiveness, how it can help or hurt, and then some of the tools that we have to help guide folks through, you know, when to replace and what to look for.
Definitely. So like I mentioned, we have, and probably Scott, it will be a good idea to send out to this group our best practices TIB, because that would definitely help you. I remember one time I had a customer and he was changing the cartridges, unnecessarily changing the cartridges, because he looked at it and it looked black. Actually, black mold is actually a good thing to have on a cartridge. That means it's been aging in the environment, moisture have gotten to it. Now it's softer. Now it has mold and things growing on it that resembles more the natural environment of termites. So this is actually helping you to actually get more termite activity in those cartridges and those stations. So the good rule of thumb is, if you poke it, and I can use a small screwdriver or a cutter pin puller, if I poke the matrix and it's still hard or I still feel resistance, is good. Just leave it alone. Now, if the screwdriver goes right through it, really soft and soggy, saturated with water, then I would consider replacing it. But for the most part, all the cartridges, actually, we have studies now that supports our cartridges can last up to 5 years in the field. And again, we're continually monitoring this so we can continue to keep you updated. Because remember, we changed the matrix at one point. We increased the compression ratio. We made our product better. And now we just have data up to 5 years, and we'll continue to let you know how long they last truly in the field. But again, it's don't look at how mold is a good thing for the cartridges. What is most important is consumption. You know, if it consumes 2/3 of the cartridges, you might need to replace it. Follow the label directions and follow the TAB that we're going to send to you guys. But keep in mind that the consistency is more important than the color of the cartridge. And again, if you're having a station placement that has a lot of moisture, that you're constantly having problems with that, there's no law prohibiting you from moving that station to a new location. Don't put them in front of a downspout. Don't put it underneath the roof drip line. So these are common good practices. If there's an area that's prone for flooding, make sure you keep them away, because termites will never be in those stations if it's flooded all the time. Yeah. Good questions there.
Yeah. As Frederick mentioned, we have a updated information bulletin on that available online with your reps, et cetera, that we can make sure everyone gets a hold of. Another question that came through, this is an interesting one. Macy is asking about treating a crawl space with termites, but that also has fungus. So basically, would you need a fungicide and an insecticide for these situations? Would you treat for both? How would you attack having two issues in one crawl space?
Is it a matter of fact, I never had this question asked. So you're going to have to mold. It's almost like mold remedial services and on top of, you know, the issue with termites. So definitely this place will have a moisture problem. So you have to make sure that you tackle that first. What caused it on the first place? Is it caused because of the pipe leak? Is it because it rain and water gets in? I would tackle that, and then I would tackle the mold issue, and then I would probably then move to the termites. The thing is, depending where, usually the mold, you're going to find it in the wood surfaces, in some of the outside part of the, could be in a wall void, but also on the side part of the, you know, block walls. So maybe the places where the mold is not necessarily the places where you need to put Termidor. But most importantly is what I'm getting at is that you don't want the mold remediation services interfering with your Termidor treatment. And if in doubt, let's say you do the Termidor treatment first, somebody comes to do a mold remediation controls or that, and if in doubt, you can always go back and retouch certain places if needed. But that's it. That's the only advice I have. Never been in a situation where I had to do both. Actually, very good question there.
Yeah, good question. That was a head scratcher for me. So I'm glad, Dr. Mm-hmm. Bretter, we have you on here to help us out. I believe those are all the questions we have in the chat. Again, if you think of something later, if you share this with a teammate and they have questions, please do check out our website. You have access to your local rep there. They can help you out or also get you in contact with our technical folks in the field. So we're definitely here to help out. As a reminder, it's April. We're almost halfway through the month or a third of the way here in April. Just a reminder, the entire month, we have our spring promo, as mentioned earlier. A lot of the products Dr. Fretter mentioned, Trelona, Advance, Termidor, et cetera, are on promotion. So you can purchase, save some money, but also get payment terms as well. So it's a really good time to stock up as you're going out and employing some of these tactics that Fretter mentioned. So we just wanted to say a big thank you. We really appreciate your time. We really appreciate your business. We appreciate your support and enabling us to continue to innovate, innovate and educate and do these type of things would not be possible without your support. So a big thank you to everyone who joined for your support and for your time today.
Thanks a lot, everyone. Appreciate it.
Thanks so much, everyone. Have a good day.